For example, we have a patient that has epigastric fullness or discomfort after eating. These two symptoms are typical symptoms of dyspepsia. But the problem here is that to say for sure it's dyspepsia or not, we can only after upper endoscopy. The major issue of endoscopy is that it's an invasive and relatively expensive procedure. So imagine if you will refer for an endoscopy every patient with such a common symptom as epigastric fullness, for example. First of all, endoscopists will be very busy, and what is more important, you will have no patients, because the reputation of a sadist will precede you. So to refer for an endoscopy or not was always a challenge. And to solve this problem, the list of so-called alarm symptoms was created. Basically, alarm symptoms in gastroenterology can be divided on alarm symptoms of upper GI tract, or so-called alarm features in dyspepsia, and alarm symptoms of lower GI tract. The alarm symptoms have high clinical value because the presence of the alarm symptom is an indication to refer for an endoscopy straight away, without, for example, PPI trial or gluten-free diet. So we have to know them. But at first glance, it's just a list of symptoms. And without understanding, it's actually very hard to memorize all of them. So this concept requires a little bit of explanation. The reason why we call them alarm symptoms is that they alarm us about something serious. And generally, there are two conditions that we are afraid of. It's cancer and bleeding. And as we look at the upper GI symptoms, most of them alarm us exactly about cancer. So if we have a patient that is older than 60, we will refer him for an endoscopy straight away. The logic here is that from the moment of birth, our organism tends to acquire mutations. Some of the mutations have a positive impact, but most of them have negative impact. For example, some mutations can disrupt cellular apoptosis. Such mutations called anti-apoptotic mutations. And generally, the longer we live, the more mutations we acquire. So with age, the mutations accumulate, and at some point, anti-apoptotic mutations can disrupt cellular apoptosis, and disruption of apoptosis is a crucial event in oncogenesis that results in formation of GI cancer. So generally, the older is the age, the higher is the risk of cancer. Moreover, as we know, some mutations can be inherited. So basically, from the moment patient was born, he could already have pro-cancer mutations. So in this case, it will take a shorter period of time to accumulate enough mutations to disrupt cell apoptosis. So in patients that have a close relative with GI cancer, generally, the risk of GI malignancy is higher. That's why family history of GI cancer is the second alarm symptom. Obviously, tumor growth occurs by a rapid proliferation of malignant cells. And proliferation requires a lot of metabolites. And the more metabolites tumor consumes, the lesser amount of metabolites left for organism. So patients with ongoing oncological malignancy unintentionally lose weight. And according to current criteria, the unintentional weight loss, more than 5% of usual body weight over 6 to 12 months, is a direct indication for an endoscopy, because it's a characteristic feature of oncological malignancy. Also, once cancer develops, malignant cells have a tendency to spread through the lymphatic system, with further accumulation in lymphatic nodes. And with accumulation of malignant cells, the size of the lymph nodes increase, a condition known as lymphadenopathy. Also, on clinical examination, it may be present as a palpable mass in the abdomen. So once we find out the palpable mass or lymphadenopathy, it's a strong indication for an endoscopy. Also, if patient has some problems with swallowing, so-called dysphagia, or swallowing provokes some painful sensation, so-called odynophagia, we can suggest that there is something that causes partial obstruction of the esophagus. And there is a possibility that it can be due to a tumor. Because if tumor growth occurs into the lumen of the esophagus, it will cause dysphagia or odynophagia. And even if it's not a tumor, then it can be some organic pathology. This partial obstruction of the esophagus can be due to a benign narrowing, due to a stricture, for example. It can be Schatzky ring, or it can be due to achalasia, for example. So there are a lot of possibilities, and definitely this condition requires more meticulous investigation. So dysphagia or odynophagia are direct indications for an endoscopy. Another alarm symptom is vomiting. Vomiting can be functional or vomiting can be caused by some organic pathology. The way to look at this, for example, violent vomiting from any cause can cause tear of the lower esophagus mucosa, and this will cause bleeding, a condition known as Mallory-Weiss syndrome. And bleeding combined with vomiting in this case will manifest as the presence of blood in the vomiting mass. And actually it's a characteristic symptom of Mallory-Weiss syndrome. So presence of blood in the vomiting mass is a direct indication for upper endoscopy, because the first priority here is to determine the source of bleeding and stop it. And also anemia in blood analysis is also indication for upper endoscopy. If microcytic anemia is present, and recall that microcytic anemia is an anemia with MCV less than 80, in this case we can assume that probably the cause of anemia is chronic bleeding. So we will search for ulcer, for example. Or if anemia is macrocytic, which is anemia with MCV greater than 100, then we assume that probably the anemia is caused by a cancer, because cancer cells, in order to proliferate, massively consume folic acid, because they require folic acid for DNA synthesis. So this will cause folic deficiency that will manifest as macrocytic anemia. So anyway, anemia requires further investigation, and because of that, we refer such patients for upper endoscopy. The same story for lower endoscopy. When patient presents with abdominal pain, the indications for lower endoscopy are age greater than 50, unintentional weight loss, family history of colon cancer, macrocytic anemia. All these symptoms indicate a higher risk of cancer in this patient. So definitely these features require further clinical investigation. Also rectal bleeding with microcytic anemia are characteristic features of lower GI bleeding. And obviously in this case, the first priority is to determine the source of bleeding and to stop bleeding. Nocturnal symptoms are also characteristic for organic pathology. Usually if pathology is functional, symptoms occur during daytime. But in some organic disorders that are accompanied by inflammation, symptoms tend to occur at night. For example, in microscopic colitis, which is a condition that is accompanied by severe inflammation in the colon, patients often have nocturnal diarrhea. So basically, if symptoms frequently occur at night, it's an indication for lower endoscopy. So it's the logic of alarm symptoms in the management of patients with gastrointestinal pathology.